hope she didn't choose Spanish.
Oh yeah, I guess that's where the whole thing was.
Offenses may or may not make for good neighbors, but they are essential for good community. Any group that seeks a unity of beliefs must draw boundaries to separate those who choose to belong from those who don't. Boundaries that distinguish acceptable practice from that which destroys community. Meet three such groups: the Mennonites, the Hutterites, and the Amish. Although these groups stem from a common origin and hold to the same central beliefs, each has chosen to draw its boundaries in different ways and at very different places. Mennonites, the largest and fastest growing of the groups, drive cars, work in a wide variety of occupations, and dress like those around them. The Hutterites began and continue as a true communal society, living in colonies and holding all property in common. The Amish are the newest of the three groups. The fences they erect and diligently maintain have created a community that stands in stark contrast to the world around it. In a world shaped by the automobile, the Amish travel in a buggy hitched to a horse. In an age of instant communication, the Amish shun television and radio and reject telephones inside their homes. In a society where fashion makes great statements that become outdated after a single season, Amish fashion continues the same statement it has made for 300 years: modesty and simplicity. In a world linked dependently to a grid of wire, the
it's
Amish
an old black
a life of self-sufficiency, powered by wood, the sun, and the wind. But, as Robert Frost observed in his poem, something there is that doesn't love a wall. In their history, the Amish, along with the Mennonites and Hutterites, have been imprisoned, tortured, executed, and exiled from their homes because their beliefs have been threatening or just incomprehensible to the world outside their boundaries. Today, the Amish continue to be harassed verbally and physically. Buggies are frequently pelted with objects, sometimes injuring, and on one occasion, killing passengers. Who are the Amish, and what is the source of their strength to remain a separate people? They are described as plain people because they live unadorned lives. They are known as the Pennsylvania Dutch because they arrived in this country as part of a wave of German-speaking immigrants drawn by William Penn's holy experiment in the 18th century. The term Pennsylvania Dutch is also used to describe the form of German still spoken by the Amish. It is the language they first learn as children, and the language they use in their most important conversations with other members of their Amish community. English is learned in school and used in contacts with the outside world. Although they appear to be relics from the past, the Amish are far from a dying breed. The Amish population is growing, with most of their members living in Pennsylvania, Ohio, and Indiana. There is no mystery behind the growth of the Amish. Large families, a strong belief in the centrality of family, labor-intensive farming practices that require hands, and prohibitions against birth control result in families that can have as many as 10 or 12 children. Three-fourths of these children remain in the Amish faith. Many of those who choose to leave transfer to Mennonite congregations. The Mennonites, the Hutterites, and the Amish cannot be understood by studying where they draw boundaries, nor can their beliefs be dismissed because each group draws its boundaries at such different places. These groups can only be understood when one begins to recognize the purpose for drawing boundaries, erecting fences, is to define more clearly the center of their beliefs. And at the center is their desire to follow Christ.
Yay!
like the Mennonites and the Hutterites. The Amish strive to live out the upside-down values to which Christ calls his followers in the Sermon on the Mount. The world tempts with status. The Amish counter with humility. The world glorifies the individual. The Amish, the subjection of the individual and community. The world honors power and might. The Amish, love that does not resist. The world listens to what a man says. The Amish see the measure of a person in what they do. The world assures that life is to be lived for today.
Listens to what a man says.
The Amish look for assurance in values that are eternal. The Amish have not been frozen.
And the Amish don't listen to the president.
They are a changing, dynamic culture.
Measure it by.
But change is not accepted haphazardly. Every change is challenged by the questions: will it enhance or harm our desire to follow Christ? Will it strengthen our community or tempt us to be more like the world? And the survival of community depends on every individual accepting a change, including it within the lines that define acceptable practice or rejecting it. Take the automobile. Why draw a line that rejects the many conveniences offered by motorized transportation? You can start with the cost.
Oh, wow.
And then there's the danger. To be responsible for another's death is a serious thing, even if you are just driving the vehicle that causes an accident. A buggy driver may be at risk himself on a modern highway, but he's not likely to cause injury or death to another. Cars use resources from the earth that cannot be replaced and that pollute. Horses not only operate on renewable fuel, they produce a byproduct that regenerates the growing power of the earth. Those who sell cars emphasize the speed, style, comfort, convenience, and status of their vehicles. All things that the Amish believe should be denied as much as possible. And sometimes you just can't depend on the fool things like you can a horse. But most serious is the effect of the automobile on family and community. With fast, easy transportation, members are apt to be away from home more often than not. And the church community is likely to disintegrate into nothing more than scattered individuals. The Amish see the individual as like a single patch of cloth, whose identity alone is insignificant, but whose presence in community makes possible a work of beauty, balance, durability, shape, and purpose. This view of the individual's place in community shapes early life. Formal education is limited because it leads to more contact with the world, which leads to loss of contact with the community, and consequently, loss of faith. The Amish emphasis on community is carried throughout all of life. Even in old age, members are supported by and live with family, never without meaningful activity, and never alone. While the Amish seem withdrawn from the world around them, they are always ready to help neighbors in their region and in their world. This help may be to rebuild from natural disasters such as fire or tornadoes, or it may take the form of raising money. Each year, the Amish participate in Mennonite-sponsored relief sales across North America to fight world hunger. Traditional foods and craft items are donated and sold in a festival-like setting. The crowning event is the quilt auction. The largest of these relief sales is held in nearby Goshen, where each year, Mennonite and Amish women piece over 300 quilts, transforming needle, thread, and countless hours into warm food and clothing for those in need. While the Amish strive for perfection, they are well aware of their human limitations. Sometimes the desire for perfection comes into conflict with the goal of perfection for the Amish: complete humility. The story is told of an Amish family leaving a Sunday morning service. The father turned to his family and said with pride, "I believe we were the plainest people there this morning. Having your wash on the line first, or your crops in the straightest row, can be another source of destructive pride for those committed to living within the boundaries of community. The prosperity that results from hard work and low-cost farming methods can threaten Amish ideas of simplicity and community. And the boundaries that keep community together are occasionally drawn too oppressively and maintained too harshly, causing some members to leave. this strict boundary maintenance has led some critics to suggest that the Amish are not living out faith, but a tightly controlled culture. But in fact, Christianity has never floated free. It has to exist in some cultural form. All who seek to follow Christ face the question, not if, but what culture do we choose? The Amish are also beginning to suffer a lack of privacy, as their unique lifestyle creates increasing curiosity among outsiders. It is ironic that a people once hunted with swords as dangerous radicals are now sought out with cameras because of their quiet, conservative ways. Sensitivity to the Amish way of life can be shown by remembering that they cannot agree to be photographed. Don't ask to take their picture or to pose with you. Many Amish do not mind being photographed at a distance. By respecting property, don't climb into buggies or walk onto farms without permission. By respecting them as a people. They are English-speaking Americans who enjoy conversation. The Mennonites, the Hutterites, the Amish. Come, listen to our story. We offer three clues to help you understand us. The first is unity amidst diversity. Listen to the beliefs that united us in 1527. Listen to the events that divided us into two bodies, the Mennonites and the Hutterites, by the middle of the 16th century. Listen to the conflict that caused a group to break away from the Mennonites and form the Amish Church at the end of the 17th century. Observe how common beliefs continue to unite the Mennonites, Hutterites, and Amish today, in spite of the wide diversity of practice that exists between the groups and within each group. The second clue is community versus communication. Fences built to preserve community can block communication with the surrounding world. The way that each group has responded to the challenge of communication has shaped the way it practices community. The third and most important clue, following Christ. Listen to the stories of how we have tried to make Christ visible through our lives, and how we have often failed. As you listen to our stories, we hope you encounter an image of the Christ that the Mennonites, Hutterites, and Amish place at the center of our beliefs, and attempt to follow in daily life.